The PL Show is brought to you by Roman Insecticide Spray and Mosquito Quill.
Mary, did you know? That's the only thing I know. Merry Christmas and welcome to the PL Show, a show that projects, works, and issues around women. Over the weeks, we've had some exceptional ladies grace our show. We've had profound conversations and more. And today is our 13th episode, and we are gratefully wrapping up the season of the Phenomenal Lady Show. Special thank you going out to our sponsors, Roma Insecticide Spray and Mosquito Quell, Intonto Master, Feco Spray Starch, Look Sharp. My name is Alikaris. There's more to come.
Shed your rumor to me.
Intonto Master, Roma Insecticide Spray at that Roma. Interfre, Intatia, make a cheha. No way!
You make no.
And tonton bako crown fanemo. And also a pussy. Roma insecticide spray and mosquito quail. And my old dear, we shall.
Roma, and quail!
Roma and tonton master.
Wow! My uniform looks different!
Feco Spray Starch! Majimo Point! Rache, pause! When you want to remember the moon to the moon, I feel you spray starch, Papa. On Japa tickles be our water, no wrinkles, smooth iron.
Yes, Papa. Feco Spray Starch. Me here perfume.
Also, yes, guys.
Feco Spray Starch.
Look sharp!
Look sharp, look sharp!
Welcome back. It is the PL Show, kindly brought to you by Roma Insecticide Spray and Mosquito Quell, Intonto Master, Feco Spray Starch, Look Sharp. Every entrepreneur faces their own share of struggles. However, some of these challenges cut across every industry. This is what some of our phenomenal ladies had to share and the way forward.
While you run this business, you are also in an active 9-to-5. How do you juggle your 9-to-5 and this one?
So that's where the weekend bit comes in. And so aside the fact that when we need to buy materials or stuff for the project, that I have to probably rush out of the office to get. But then aside that, everything is done over the weekend. And so it doesn't really cause chaos, for want of a better word. Weekdays are for my research assistant job. Okay. And then weekends solely for my project.
How are you working out these two equally demanding jobs?
So the difficult times was when I started, but thankfully I was going to work in the afternoon. So I was able to work in the morning and then just switch. But then with time, I have staff that help me. And also, you know, you need to be loyal to your employer and loyal
and
to your business.
Customers.
And to your customers as well.
Right.
That's why I wake up as early as 3 a.m. To sort out everything and make sure that by 10 a.m. I'm in the office, I'm seated, like, and then...
And you close in the evening?
Yes.
It must be really difficult for you.
It's difficult, but then when you're passionate
about the end goal.
I learned very early when I started the business, when it got really difficult. I spoke to some of the women who have been there. I went to Jokal, the lady who makes the Jokal Shito. I didn't know her from anywhere, but I traced her. Fortunately, she was in Tema.
Wow.
So I went to her and I asked her a few questions as to what I can do and all of that. And in fact, when I was going, it was about sourcing for the right packaging and doing this, but she took the trouble to lecture me. And she was so gracious. She told me a lot about what is yet to come. when you get married, when you have children, what it can do to your business and all of that. So I learned very early that I can't do it all by myself. I need help. I need to delegate. And so I get all the help I want. I have one extended family member, brother Kwesi, who lives with me. He cooks, he does everything. It's not like I leave all the cooking for him to do. We do it together. But when I have to travel, when I have to be away, he can be there and take care of that. I make the time, but I also acknowledge that I can't do it all.
As an entrepreneur, what's been your most challenging moment?
Oh, the many challenging moments. I still have challenging moments.
You do?
I mean, it's the kind of business that it takes a lot for a client to be happy. You can give them a great meal and just delaying the bill can trigger, you know, somebody who's already having a bad day. So it's the kind of business that every process is important, from how you take the order to the client actually leaves your door. Anything can go wrong. And it sometimes depends on how the client feels coming in. They may already be having a bad day, you know, maybe the wife's upset him or the husband's upset her, or she's having a bad day at work. And so it might take just something very simple to just trigger, you know, a little outburst. And that doesn't really look good for us. So out of the moments, we get plenty moments.
Was there ever a day you felt like, I'm tired of this, let me just shut down and mind my own business?
Once in a while. Once in a while. But I mean, I've also been really blessed by this business. I've met a lot of people. It's the kind of business that allows me to tap into different levels of my creativity. It gives me time to write. So I mean, I always say you can't point at your village with your left hand. You have to be appreciative, irrespective of the challenges. You have to be appreciative of what somewhere or something does for you, you know. So you want to focus more on the pluses than the minuses. Yeah.
Right. So it would seem that, I mean, the way you tell the story, it would seem that things came to you naturally.
No.
How challenging has your journey been?
I would say very challenging in terms of finance, I would say. I'm the kind of person that doesn't give up easily, most especially like what I have to touch. Because I used to always say to myself, this is the only thing that has my name on it. The company, the brand, is the only thing I feel has my name on it. And I could never watch it go down, ever. So for me, it's like fighting, win-win, to have it up. And for like 9 years, I've had it there amidst all the turmoil and everything, losing my financials, going down, coming up. It's always about sustaining the brand. That's like my number one. And I remember at that time when I was making some money from the jobs that I was doing, I used to say to myself that it's not always going to be this rosy. I'm not always going to have my finances looking like this. So it was best that I put a lot and focus a lot in my business so that when the hard times come, I would have like something to fall back on. This was the notion with which I created the brand too. And apart from financial constraints I had from time to time, it was the issue of staff. Workers, and still is the issue of workers, because I had a top-notch look for the brand. I had a certain type of finishing that I wanted on the clothes, and whenever I launched a collection, there was something that I looked out for. But it was hard to kind of relate with the workers to identify or understand what you're trying to put out there. And you even try to have mood boards to launch a collection and you realize that they don't get the aesthetics of what you are. The tailors don't get it. And sometimes the quarrels we will have in the work area will be, oh, but it's just okay, take it like this. But you see, tailoring, craftsmanship was like the whole thing for me. And it was about bringing a detailed form of something that when my critics put it down, they can actually look at it and say, this is wrong. This is not for fashion. This is not tailored right. This finishing is bad. That was what I had to cut off. And if I had to sell to the international market, I had to be particular about finishing. And so I had to be particular about my stuff. So how
did you carry them along that journey of letting them know your dream?
What happened was I had to go in and bring the workers from Cote d'Ivoire into Ghana. And this was like very huge for me because you have to house them and you have to pay them 3 times the price you're paying your Ghanaian staff.
Okay.
Yes.
So how many of them did you bring in? It sounds expensive to me.
for starters, I brought in two.
Okay.
But eventually, I had to end up with five. Then I blend the Ghanaian workers because I could not be in the Ghanaian terrain and not employ Ghanaians.
I hope that has provided you with some entrepreneurial lessons and how to keep striving for the best. Now let's move on to some of our phenomenal ladies who are making strides in a male-dominated industry.
When I had my interview, one of the questions they asked was, so how do I feel like being a woman working, with males, because mining is generally a male-dominated mm-hmm. industry. And I said, what's different about men? Nothing. We sit in class with men, we beat them at their game, mm-hmm. we excel them. So I think that we all have the same brain and we all do well. But for me, that was a question. But I realized that the company didn't really care about your gender. All they saw was a person. So it didn't matter whether you're a female or a male, they saw a person. And once a person was willing to work, it didn't matter whether you're a female, they were going to work with you.
Did you encounter any gender-related challenges? You know, people thinking, well, mm-hmm. you're a woman, let mm-hmm. the men do it. Or yeah. people, you know, shrugging at you mm-hmm. because, you know, you're a woman.
It's happened at every job, but sooner or later, it dissipates because the work speaks for itself. But obviously, as women, we're constantly having to prove ourselves. That's not going to change today, but we just have to keep forging forward and doing what we're doing, and then the work speaks. Mm. Instead of you speaking about how I am a woman mm. and how I'm going to do it, right. just get it done. That speaks volumes in itself.
Right. Do you find yourself meeting a lot of women in the mining industry since, you know, you started?
Yes, increasingly. When I started, there weren't a lot. Mm-hmm. There were just a few. But now, we are seeing a lot of them. In Ashanti, Anglo Ashanti, they have a number of women working there, not only in administration, but in all the other parts, in metallurgy, in the processing plants, in the underground, you're seeing that. With Golden Star Resources, we made a conscious effort mm-hmm. to make sure that we brought women on board. Mm. So we got young ladies who went into the mining school through the University of Mines mm-hmm. and then came to work with us. So we have a lot of lady mining engineers. We have drill masters who are ladies. We really have ladies across the board. Okay. We have a fantastic lady who is in our business processing, and she's helped to turn the business itself around.
Some people would say, it's yeah. a men's job, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
But share some of those experiences with you when you met men and people who had been in the industry longer than you have.
You know, photography has taught me something. Photography has taught me that a man is a man anywhere and everywhere. There's nothing like an African man or an European man mm-hmm. when it comes to ego.
Okay.
In 2005, when I was going to take my first soccer shots, men laughed at me, right?
Mm-hmm.
They laughed. They were like, you think you're coming to play here?
Mm-hmm.
That was Ghanaian men, right?
Yeah.
In 2014, my second World Cup in Brazil, a group of French photographers, when somebody is talking about you, they shook their head, you know, looked at me up and down. That's Brazil, that's French people.
Uh-huh.
So you see, everybody looks down at you. The thing is, I believe that at the end of the day,
mm-hmm.
let them think whatever they want to think of you. Yes. Your work, your output shows.
It's difficult to
say. It is difficult. I think you need a bit of rebellion in you
mm.
to survive
mm.
the training,
mm.
the practice,
mm-hmm.
the training and the practice.
Mm.
My rebellion was slightly different from his. Mine was that if I sat in a lecture hall and a lecturer was saying A is equal to that or this is because of that, I will question it.
Mm.
And I'll keep questioning it.
Mm.
This is a training where if you question too much too, you can be victimized. There's a lot of victimization. Some of us withstood the victimization. Some people coil back and then you become timid and you don't get to explore
mm.
so much. But there has to be a bit of rebellion in you
yeah.
to stand whatever is coming.
Kudos to our men who are supporting women in their work environment. Now let's move on to some of our phenomenal ladies who are keeping it together when it comes to work and family.
So you finally settled in Ghana.
In Ghana.
But you had to do something for yourself.
Yes, in Ghana, because I didn't bring anything. Mm-hmm. My sister's husband gave me 150, which is 15 cedis now in 1990. So I have to be on the street to sell materials. That's the only money that can afford materials. Those lighter materials, I started by the roadside in front of Makola Market. I did that for 4 years. Okay. Then I had a little on top of it. Then my stepmother used to be in Makola Market, mm-hmm. who sell cloth. Say, Juliana, you know this street vending will not help because we're running up and down. They've been chasing us from the streets and all that. And you know I'm not used to that. But because there is nothing for me to do to survive with the children, of course my sister and her husband was helping. But I, as a trader, I couldn't sit watching. So I approached my stepmother in the market and she said that she would give me a place.
Throughout the journey, mm-hmm. along the line came a husband, it came a family, and share a story with us. Sometimes it gets difficult, you know. I have two young ones, mm-hmm. and sometimes if I don't have my mother, I think that I wouldn't survive it. So what has it been like for you?
For me, I think it's applying the principles that has helped me in my career. So one is the fact that there's nothing too difficult you can do. That was one. Two, that there always will be challenges, but if you put your mind to it, you always will overcome that challenge. So that was one. The third one is the fact that how do you get a team of supporters? Because you can't do it alone, mm-hmm. so collaboration. And I've applied that to myself. So yes, I got married. I got married when I was in VRA. Yes, and then came along a husband. Then I had my first child. Then right after my first child, I moved into SGSSB. Mm-hmm. So I went with a very young baby into a new organization where communications or public relations was being set up again.
Right.
So it was back again, the principle of your willingness to bend backwards and go the extra mile. So if I was willing to go the extra mile, it meant that I needed that support. So my mm-hmm. mother was alive then.
Right.
So my mother...
She was your support.
Yeah, she was my support. So I'll go and leave my daughter there, drive to work,
oh
get home around 6, 7, with the mother sitting on the porch saying, oh have you forgotten your mother?
Oh dear, I know that feeling all too well. From the very onset, you've been business-minded, you've yes. been a woman on a career path, but you had children along the line. Now, how are you mixing that? You know, the family on one hand, the career on the other. At some point, you had your children in the yes. U.S. So how did you mix that?
It's not so much a mix as it's a juggle.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't have done it without my mom and my mom's sister, my aunt, Auntie Nelly. My mom and my aunt just gave me full support. They were working too,
right.
but they made sure that they took time off to spend with my children when right. I wouldn't be at home. I had unusual working hours. At Ashanti, I would go to work by 6:37, and I wouldn't close till the US market would close, which is more like 9. But I did take long breaks at lunchtime, and I would have siesta.
Okay.
And that's when the children would come home and I'd spend time with them. So right. that even if I came home and they were already in bed, that was fine. So my children interacted with me. I guess the girls have picked my style of work
mm-hmm.
and my style of being at home. And they seem to be exhibiting that now. They don't make a fuss about children uh-huh. and they just move on with their lives in terms quickly. Of getting their career going. Right.
Now that is the impact of a balanced life, of course with support from the family, coming from Honorable Muna Helen Kwate. We'll be right back.
Should you rumor to me?
I don't know, Master.
Yes, oh my daddy.
Roma insecticide spray at that Roma. Interfre, Intatia, Mikacheha. No way!
Kemikunu, and Tuntumbako crown fanimo. And also a pussy. Roma insecticide spray and mosquito crown. And my old dear, we a sham.
Roma,
Roma and Tuntum Master.
Yena, yena. Maketiano, why are you?
And one.
Oh!
Tum, tum, preco,
Sasso,
Mwa,
Sasso,
Papano, or you Sasso. Deny Sasso.
Yes, 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 yes,
yes,
Madame, and yes,
yes, yes,
yes, yes,
yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes, yes,
Welcome back to the PL Show. This is our season finale. Don't worry if you missed out on our previous editions. We are bringing you all the highlights. Bed Oak products. Brown sugar is obtained from natural and refined pure sugar cane and rich with molasses. We also have Sika cereal mix. It's made with a blend of wheat, soya bean, and rice. All these products to improve your health. To contact them, the number is on our screens. Also, do show us some love on all our social media platforms. Underscore the PL Show on Instagram and Twitter, the PL Show on Facebook. Now, our phenomenal ladies share some important life lessons with us.
When I was growing up, when I see somebody in the area who does say Nkati cake and all of those things, I tend to go and help so when they finish, I can get something to nibble on. And I think I learned some of these things from those experiences. That's why I always tell the people that I get to work with and I mentor, and I tell them that it is not always about working to get a salary. Sometimes you could be giving help and then you tend to learn. You may not even see it at that point, but later on when life really gets to you, strikes you and you want to do something, those are the experiences that you put into action that will propel you to get to where you want to be.
You don't know everything, but every day you learn. I'm still learning. I've been with Maisha for 6 years as a program director, so I'm every single day I feel like I'm in a class. With the Fresh Craft series we just shot here, I learned so much. Just to being open to that and to understand that it never ends. As long as you're living, eating, breathing, it does not end. And you've got to want it. If you don't want it, it won't come to you. You've got to want it, you've got to look for it. You've just got to nurture that thing, the thing that your heart is telling you, this is what I want the rest of my life to be about. You've got to fight for it. Well, nobody can fight for it for you but yourself.
I mean, as a person, you are there to create value. And creating that value is not about you. So it's almost like, don't take yourself serious. Life is not all about you. It's about how do you impact people? How do you help lift people up? How do you support others to be where they are not? That's what I care about. It's how have I encouraged others that nothing is impossible, that there's nothing that they cannot do if they put themselves in, that if they fail, I mean, we all will go through ups and downs. When you're down, there'll be the time that you go up. So don't focus on the down. Focus on what can I do, what strategy, what plan can I put in place? And then maybe one, two, or three plan. My plan, my team knows it's plan A, plan B, plan C. If plan A fails, you kick in plan B. If plan B fails, you kick in plan C. If plan C fails, go back to plan A.
So. And I quote Madam Adiki, there's nothing too difficult you can't do. There will always be challenges, but you can overcome. Also, get people, get a team to work and grow with. And I add, choose wisely. Let's listen to some more wise words from highly successful women.
So I am sure that people should know their body shapes and what works for them. There is so much information on the internet, but then of course you need customized information that works for you too. Kemini, one more thing. I see a lot of Ghanaian girls having very cluttered appearances. Cluttered because when they are putting themselves together, they don't know what is the statement they are putting across. So Kemini, if a woman wants to be a bit sensual in her appearance, like a knight, you show a bit of skin at the upper part. If you are doing the upper part, you need to cover the lower part of your body. If you are showing arms, you show arms, you show legs, you cover the rest of your body. If your back is so low, you cover the front, so that you call attention to just one part of your body. So I choose to wear a long covering dress and I bring the slit up here so that all attention would be on my $1 million legs. So you don't slit it up, put the back down, show your cleavage, everything at once.
That's too
much.
It
is not classy. It is trashy. We need to mind that.
Oh, pun intended, by the way. Pun intended. It is not classy. It is trashy.
I would advise any young person who is in architecture, thinking about it, not sure, that if you're considering it, go ahead, go through it and give it your best. With us, you learn, you figure out what best works for you, because thankfully architecture is not narrow, it's really, really broad. There's so much you can do. I think in Ghana, we don't even scratch the surface of what architecture could be. There are people who design taps. There are people who just design facades. There are people who research into materials. There's so much you can do. And so if you take it seriously enough to understand what architecture is, you'll be able to find your own niche and develop your style of architecture, which may end up being what the world actually needs.
I would say people should strive for excellence and try and do the best wherever they find themselves. And try and commit, even if you're working for somebody, commit to that job whilst you're there, make an impact. And then if you need to move on, you can move on. I find that generally, and I've run a business for 20 years, 21 years, so we don't take ownership of somebody else's vision. We, in our mind, I'm working hard so that you can have a good life. You forget that every month, you also are part of that good life. So I think for young people to try and take ownership wherever they are, commit to businesses. If you want to do something for yourself, yeah, you know, you can do that. But if you're working for somebody, show some commitment, give of yourself, give of your best, grow that person's business. And whilst you're doing that, you'll be growing personal skills that you can take to either your next job or your next business.
I've always been in leadership positions wherever I've been, because I get things done and because I want to live. I want my life to reflect, you know, like onto the next person. So even being at Maisha, even being here, you know, every girl I meet who wants to be an actress, I'm always constantly telling them you could be more powerful behind the screen, not necessarily in front of the screen. And of course, you find that, I actually find that it's access to information, access to opportunity, mentorship that doesn't normally happen in the African society as it truly does happen, but there's no targeted, this person is mentoring you for your career. So in as much as it's been accidental, I've been a grab and go kind of person. And so in my line of work also, I talk a lot to young women to think beyond this little thing you think you could do. You could do 10 times what you're thinking about right now. Right. So it's just about helping them just dream bigger. Indeed. For themselves.
So for me, anytime I'm talking about choosing a career, and I say this to my children, and I say this to my volunteers, and I say this to everyone, I also lecture a lot, so I bring that up. You draw three circles, yeah?
Okay.
So one, two, three. One is love, one is passion, and one is money. And the three circles must all meet. And when three things meet, you always have a middle there somewhere.
That's right.
That is where you need to put your career. So you must love your whatever you do as much as you are passionate about. Okay. Love and passion is not the same thing.
Yeah.
So you must be passionate about it, and then you must find a way to make money from it. And if you can find the intersection of these three, you've discovered gold.
Mm. Women are just better managers of people and of the purse. I mean, I absolutely believe that. Women manage people so much better and manage the purse so much better. We will have the odd rotten egg here and there, but generally, women are so much better. Because I believe this so strongly, I actually am not a full supporter of affirmative action. Because I believe that we can hold our own, we can stand our ground. And if given the chance, and I know I use that carefully, given the chance, as if someone needs to give us the chance. But you know, in this life, being given the chance can be both from male and from female.
Right.
Females can give you the chance,
right.
Male can give you the chance. If you notice, women really form the majority of, whether it's voting or in churches or even in organizations,
yes.
You have more women than men. If that caucus could give itself the chance to make sure that a woman led them, they would benefit from it. So for the young ladies, I would say, don't go the route of affirmative action. Go the route of merit. Go the route of being confident, studying, gaining experience, knowing that as you go forward to take this position, you can do it.
Don't be afraid, because there's always fear. I mean, as human beings, there always should be fear. You go through that moment of fear. There's always that self-doubt, but don't let that hold you back. So you're going through challenges, and we've all gone there. I mean, I started from public agenda as a journalist. I walked from Asylum down to the Supreme Court to cover stories. I could have looked at that time and said, oh, when am I ever going to make it? So I started from somewhere. So they should look back and understand that I didn't start off life and become a vice president. It's taken me 22 plus years to be where I am. So no matter where you are, there is a future and success out there. All you have to do is that you should be willing to learn. You should be willing to bend yourself backwards and go the extra mile at work. So if there's work to be done, are you the person who picks your bag up at 5 and say, well, you pay me peanuts, so it's 5 o'clock, my family bag, me coffee? No. It's not about the pay. It's about the value, because whatever you're doing, you're adding the value to yourself, not to the company. Yeah, you're adding to your company, but to yourself. And one day you're going to take that skill set that you've acquired and when apply it to your life. So in whatever you're doing, no matter how much they pay, no matter how much pressure your boss, take it positively, bend backwards, do the best, solve the problems that keep your boss awake at night. And learn. And when you die, we write on your tomb, here lies the tomb. Of the tombstone of this young person who learned to them.
Of course, life isn't all about you, but the impact you make. And let's all uplift each other. Nothing is impossible. I'll be right back.
Shed your rumor to me.
And Tonton Master, Roma insecticide spray at that Roma. Interfret, Entatia, make it ha. No way!
Kemikunu, and Tuntum Bako Crown Fanimo, and also a pussy. Roma insecticide spray and mosquito cream. And how dare we a sham?
Roma,
Roma and Tuntum Master.
Wow! My uniform looks different!
Feko spray starch! Majimo point! Rache, pause! When you want to remember na munto do moon? Afini enya spray starch, papa! On japa tickles be our water, no wrinkles! Smooth iron!
Yesham, papa! Feko spray starch! Me here perfume!
Aso, ye guy!
Feko spray starch!
Look sharp!
Look sharp! Look sharp!
Yena, yena. Maketiano, why are you?
And one.
Oh!
Tum, tum, prego.
Yes, so.
Mwawa, mwawa.
Sasso.
Papa, no. Oh, you sasso. Yena, yes, sasso.
Yes, yes. And yes, sasso. Madam, and yes, sasso.
Yes, sasso.
What? What?
Sasso.
And more beyond that, thou. Sasso. A cum tum. Nim wawa, mwawa, sasso. Cum tum, prego.
Welcome back. Let me appreciate our sponsors again. Roma Insecticide Spray and Mosquito Quell. Roma and Tonton Master. Feco Spray Starch Look Sharp. Let's take a look at some of the amazing products Samara Home Care provides. A fantastic festive season with products from Samara Home Care. Up next is your favorite segment, hashtag trending. Catch up with the fun, the excitement, and more. It's been an insightful 12 weeks experience engaging some awesome young women in diverse fields. My name is Elikaris and this is Hashtag Trending. On today's edition, I bring you the excitement, the fun, a recap of the season shortly. Let's kick it off with young entrepreneurs in real estate and educational sector. So at the age of 20 years, you built a 3-bedroom apartment and completed your first sale. When did you pick an interest in real estate and technology?
Well, I picked my interest in property development actually as a child with my dad. And I remember when I see big buildings, I was an indoor baby, but very troublesome, you know. So when we went out sometime for grocery shopping, I saw these big buildings in a room somewhere in Kumasi. I was so excited. So I told him I would want to build such big houses for us to stay in. And he kept telling me they are for offices. So one day said, I'll build such for you for your office because your office is small. So relating to real estate and technology, if I should say, I didn't necessarily have to be in a classroom or have a degree to start. I knew this is what I wanted to do, but then I did some short courses online and I applied for UCT online course with the University of Cape Town, studying property development and investment. All right. So most of the stuff I learned online.
It is such an honor to finally meet you, the global teacher. How are you doing?
I'm fine.
How you are look you? Good.
Thank you so much for having me.
First of all, is the plan of becoming a president someday part of the goals?
I did a little bit whisper to you because, yeah, I'd love to.
Well,
yeah.
I'm looking forward to that. The first female president in Ghana.
But where would you vote for me, though?
I'll be your campaign manager.
Oh, thank you so much.
Nice Lydia. To meet you once
Pleasure
again and
you.
Making time for us.
Thank you.
Where from Global Teacher?
It's funny because a lot of people think, okay, because I'm into education and, you know, I work with children. But no, I woke up one day, I asked myself, what's my purpose on earth? You know, I'm known to do a lot of things. I'm pretty sure, you know. And I asked myself, if I'm to walk into a place and they asked, who are you? You know, people are engineers, people are doctors and all that. What would I want to be called? And it just dawned on me, I think God spoke to me that I'm a teacher. And then I asked him, well, but this is before I started a school or anything else. So I'm like, what do you mean I'm a teacher? And he said to me, I'm able to teach people everywhere, anytime, at every point. Even things that I do not know, you know, things that I have no experience with. So he just said to me, you are a teacher on a global level, not because you, okay, it's Ghana or Nigeria or whatever, but then the fact that
beyond
that, you know, the fact that you can teach universally on any topic and all that. So I was like, whoa, that's crazy. I have always been someone who had a mind of my own, not to follow any trend, not to follow what anyone is doing, but then to find a passion and really live up to it. The main reasons why I write for children, for example, is for them to have access to materials to read all the time. But then in Ghana, you know, you've heard stories about we not being a reading nation. So even if you're giving someone free material to read, you need to actually beg them and to ensure that they're doing it. So I just think that we need to shift our focus a little bit more. When people are well educated, it's easier to transform them, because when you talk about policies, for example, you have only 15 to 20% of the whole population understanding what you're talking about. How do we then make sure that we push your policies forward? And so for me, I really, really wish that the government, individuals, philanthropists, you know, whoever, are able to embrace, you know, people who are trying to push literacy in Ghana, because that's the way to go.
To our ladies who like to nail the look for every occasion, when it comes to hair, makeup, and a whole lot more, this was what we had in our beauty session.
It varies when it comes to straight hair. You don't need, if it's a human hair, we have the virgin hair. You don't need extra oils and other products to it. All you need is, I have one product, it's my secret. I don't want to share it out there, but it's just like, just to take the frizz out of it. It makes it shiny and that's it. I don't put too much products in my original, like the virgin hair. And then when it comes to the, let's say the wavy and then the curly hair, you just need water. Water is good. Nothing else. Don't put more products. It's just like your hair. Don't put any product. If you put too much product, you know, the dust and everything absorbs into the hair and it becomes very dry and dirty, if I have to put it that way. When you come to the salon, we check your hair texture and everything. If it needs treatment, we go ahead and treat it for you. Before you sleep, you scalp your hair. Just scarf it, excuse me. you don't sleep on the cotton pillow bed like that.
I never knew.
Yeah, you don't. The friction in there, you know, this is cotton. And then when you sleep on it, when you're going back and forth, like turning yourself, and you're not having any hair bonnet on your head, you're just tearing your hair, just making it messy. Wow. And some is coming off eventually.
What do you seek to achieve when you pick up the brush to work on a client?
When I pick my brushes or a client sits in front of me, automatically I'm thinking about the client as myself. She wants to get out fast and she wants to look close to herself as possible but look beautiful. So when somebody sits in my chair, I seek to enhance the natural features of the person, you know, ultimately just to empower the woman to show up 100% looking her best and empower her to achieve more. It's very important that on the big day, as a makeup artist, I did mention earlier that we're not just artists, but we're like a therapist. A lot of things, you know, happen on that day. People are calling in, things are not going well, decor. The bride tends to freak out. But to make her stand out means to make her relax, to make her calm down, you know. But beyond that, when it comes to the makeup, you want to make sure that throughout the day, her makeup is intact. You know, if she's dancing, the makeup is not bleeding. And it all depends on your preparation, how you prep the skin before you put makeup on it. It's very important. You have to moisturize the skin properly. Even before the day, you have to advise or encourage the bride to take good care of her skin, because whatever happens, whether she drinks a lot of water, she rests, all of that will reflect in her standing out on the day.
A healthy mind is a healthy body. The experts shared some useful tips during our health and fitness conversation.
If I come to you and I tell you I'm pregnant, what is this?
So I would want to know what stage of pregnancy you are. Is it your first trimester? Is it your third trimester? Has your doctor given you permission to do safe exercises? Because some pregnancies are not safe. You cannot work out. You know, some of them you would have to stay in bed even throughout your pregnancy. Some of them, because of the delicate situation surrounding your pregnancy, your doctor might tell you to just, you know, stay quiet. Don't do any giddy activities. But if your pregnancy is safe and you've been given the nod to do simple physical activities, then yes, you are my person. In your first trimester, that's when the fetus is settling. It's now going to attach and all that. So sometimes you're not too sure if your fetus has attached properly. So you want to take your time, you want to relax. Sometimes in your first trimester, your hormones are all over the place. So you're stressed, you're unstable, you're not sleeping well. So that's not, I really would not advise that you start working out in your first trimester. But if you're sure that everything is okay with you, most of the time from 10 weeks going, you're safe to exercise. But when I say safe to exercise, there are different kinds of activities you can do when you're pregnant. Some that are safe for first trimester, some that are safe for second, some that are safe for third. Yeah, so you can do safe first trimester activities. So we're going to do jabs. So here, 1, 2. Come on, let's go. 1, 2. I'm lifting off onto my knee. 1. And you're breathing. Breathing is such an essential thing when you're pregnant. In through your nose, out through your mouth. So this is jab.
Bliss Yoga Accra has been running now for almost 7 years. And when I first opened the studio, a lot of people had questions about what yoga was and is. And because it was also developed in India over 5,000 years ago, we do have associations to another culture. And so people have assumptions about what that means. But what yoga is a physical exercise. It was developed because people in India 5,000 years ago had ailments like headaches, backaches, anxiety, maybe even depression. And they needed to find something to do to resolve that. So they developed a set of postures that people could do on a regular basis to help the body and the mind. And that's how it developed. It then traveled around the world. It made its way to Africa. It made its way to Europe. It made its way eventually in the early 90s, obviously, to the US. And it became something that's now like an $80 trillion business. But what it does is it helps the body. It's a physical exercise, but eventually as you do the physical exercise over and over again, of course it helps your mind. So I think we're breaking the myth in Accra and Ghana because we have now seen that our student volumes have changed. And now a majority of our students are of African descent at Bliss Yoga. You have people who have injuries. We do have athletes that come here and they're able to resolve working to strengthen their muscles. And then you also have a lot of people who generally have general stress from work. And so over the time that they've been practicing with us, they've found tools to be able to go out there, change, and help themselves with stress-related, probably work-related, or even at home challenges. So it's for everyone, it's all different ways, but a lot of the changes come from who the student is.
In fields dominated by men, quite a number of young ladies in Ghana are making their strides.
Women have been doing photography for the longest time. Lindsay Adelaide, Suze Bryce, like there are a lot of
in Ghana.
No, in Ghana, like yes. If you're talking globally. But I think it's Ghana now that the trend is like now picking up. And I think our generation is different. I mean, what men can do, women can do it better. From watching American Next Top Model, I just love how the images come out, and I always ask myself how they're doing it. So I started like getting interest, and I'm like, okay, I want to do this. But it's like a man's profession, so you always have that thing, oh, how are people going to take it when I say I want to be a photographer? And then there is always that photo kind of thing. But as I said, our generation is different and things are changing. So I think now it's cool. Even if you're like a female photographer, you're like, cool.
Making pencil lines come to reality, to make it look like a real thing, is very, very fulfilling. Seeing my clients and people get excited when they get the artwork and all that, makes me very, very excited. The person I like to draw that I haven't drawn already is very, very alive. I mean, she's Oprah. I mean, everybody knows Oprah. I like to draw her because she's really done a lot for women. She's really empowered women. And then listening to her story from where she was and how far she's come, I really admire her. So I would like to draw Oprah.
The thing is, during service, I realized I didn't want to pursue anything in culture at this time. I realized I found my passion for art and decided to go with that. Right now, art is like my lifestyle. So whatever it is I decide to add to art will definitely have some elements of art in it. I started painting in 2015, so it's almost 4 years now. And it didn't take long. I actually started with making pencil portraits. And then I just painted a room one day, and then it was beautiful. And that is where my career started from.
Getting into music, first I was in school and trying to balance doing music and studying. And it was hard. But when I finished school, I'm like, you know what? I want to try music full time. Let's see how it goes. And I think I was just motivated by people around me and my family. It's been a crazy journey. I'm not going to lie. But it's been good. Having to be the very first female Ghanaian to be signed to Universal, it was very life-changing because I keep asking them that, where did you guys find me? Like, how did you, like...
How did you know about
exactly,
me?
Exactly, because I released my song 1201, and the next day I got a call from them. Amazing, right? So I asked them, where did you find me? And they said, they saw me on YouTube, they saw me on Twitter. So I feel like sometimes people don't take their social media seriously, but you never know who's watching, you really never know. So just keep putting stuff out. So it's been life-changing. I've been independent my whole career. So working with a label was hard. Adjusting to like, now you wake up in the morning, you have a schedule. See, now you have to go here, you have to do this. You want to release a song, or maybe when you record a song, they'll listen to like five people say, change here. It was hard, I'm not going to lie. But first, I'm on my own. So I do it, I think it's fine. I'll record it, I'll put it out. But I think I've learned to be disciplined, and yeah, it's been good.
We do appreciate all our phenomenal ladies who have passed through the show. Their level of commitment to succeed is outstanding. Special thank you going out to you all for tuning in every Sunday to watch us and not forgetting our sponsors, Roma Insecticide Spray and Mosquito Quell. Do get some this Christmas and get rid of all the mosquitoes.
Come, they told me, ba-ra-ba-ba-ba. A newborn king to see, ba-ra-ba-ba-ba.
And this is our beautiful cake from Jay's Cakes. You can find them on Instagram, Jay's Cakes GH. Thank you so much for this beautiful cake, and I can't wait to cut and taste. Also enroll at their institute and be your own boss. I call our production manager to help me cut the cake. Christy, it's a season already. How do you feel?
I feel great. First of all, we have to thank the Almighty God for how far He has brought us. And then to our crew, to our guests, to our presenters, we must say a big thank you to all of them. I would like to say a big thank you to our EP, executive producer Cecilia Opombedu, then our producer director, Miss Sheila Ajima.
Now we cut the cake, but before that, it has been a remarkable season of the Phenomenal Lady Show. Thank you to you, our loyal viewers, to our phenomenal ladies who have graced the show. We are thankful for your time and insights. To our sponsors, we are truly grateful. We are truly grateful for all the support. And of course, the crew, they can't join us. Christy is representing them. They are behind the camera doing the work. Yes, we've been through a lot, but it has been the grace of God that has brought us this far. Now, time to cut the cake.
Woo.
And then the two of us will enjoy it.
Yeah, we'll not give them.
All right.
So, hand over the
3, 2, 1. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Wishing you many blessings, much happiness, and even more love this Christmas and the new year. Watch out for season 2 of the PL show.
Yay.
My name is Ellie Karis. Thank you. Mwah!